Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. In this video, we're going to look at the role of expectations on IQ scores. So we have the idea of a self-fulfilling prophecy, and this refers to a situation in which an expectation actually causes the expected result to occur. Now, we saw an example of this in the unit on research methods, because I talked about a study by Robert Rosenthal and Kermit Fode in which college students were given rats to run in some mazes. And the students were told that some of the rats were maze bright rats and some were maze dull rats. And after running the rats in these mazes, the students found that the bright rats outperformed the dull rats. Now, this wouldn't be surprising, except that the rats were actually randomly distributed. There were no bright or dull rats. And this meant that the difference in performance was likely due to the differing expectations that students had about the rats. So this was a good demonstration of observer bias. And in this video, we're going to take a look at the role of teacher expectations on student performance. And this brings us to another study conducted by Robert Rosenthal. And here's a picture of Rosenthal here. And in this study, he collaborated with an elementary school principal, Lenore Jacobson. And what Rosenthal and Jacobson did was they gave all of the students at a California elementary school a test at the beginning of the school year. Now, they said that the test was the Harvard test of inflective acquisition. And the idea was this was a test that could identify which students were most likely to improve in the coming year. And so after this test, they gave teachers a list of the 20% of students who were most likely to make quick improvements in the coming year. They were likely to spurt in their development. So we had this 20% of students who were identified to be spurters by this test. And then at the end of the school year, 8 months later, the students took the test again. Now, the test was not actually the Harvard test of inflected acquisition. That was a made-up name. It was actually an IQ test. It was a test by J.C. Flanagan called the test of general ability, or the TOGA test, which assesses verbal IQ as well as abstract reasoning IQ. And so what Rosenthal and Jacobson wanted to see was whether there was a difference between these 20% spurter students and the rest of the students at the school. And these 20% of students were actually randomly selected. So there was no test for identifying which students were going to bloom. They just randomly picked 20% of students and told the teachers, hey, these are the kids to watch for. These kids are going to improve a lot this year. And then they wanted to see, did those differing expectations that the teachers had actually have an influence on the retest at the end of the year? And it turns out that they did. The students who were identified as being spurters, who were likely to make the most gains in that school year, actually did improve more than the rest of the students. So those 20% of spurters showed greater improvement. And this was especially true for the younger grades. So this effect was strongest for students in grade 1. And the effect was not really there by grade 6. So this suggests that it could be the case that students have reputation that sort of follows them, and so the grade 1 students don't have any prior reputation with the teachers, and so these expectations might be stronger, and by grade 6 maybe they're weakened a bit. Or it could be the case that students who are younger are more susceptible to teacher influence, so the expectations teachers have play a greater role on influencing those students. Or it could be the case that teachers themselves vary, so that grade 1 teachers and the expectations they have are acted out differently than they are for grade 6 teachers, let's say. But in any case, we do see this measurable difference in the students who were identified as being spurters compared to the other students. And there was also a slight difference between boys and girls in terms of whether their verbal IQ improved, which was more likely for boys to occur, and their abstract reasoning, which actually improved more in girls who were identified as being these spurters. But the point is that teacher expectations were influencing the results on the subsequent test. So why might this be? Well, it could be the case that teachers behave differently towards these students. So teachers might call on students who they believe have greater potential more often. Or perhaps they'll encourage them more persistently. If the student starts struggling, the teacher thinks, you know, this kid can do it. You know, I know that he has the potential. And so they might focus a little bit more of their efforts on helping these students to improve, whereas other students who weren't considered to have this potential for improvement might not receive as much attention. So this brings us to the idea that students experience different environments. Even when they're in the same classroom with the same teacher, the teacher's behavior might change slightly from student to student, and this could have an impact on the student's abilities. Now, we can also think of more extreme differences in student environments when we think about the practice of tracking that schools engage in. And tracking refers to the idea that students are placed into groups based on early performance. So students who are identified to have the greatest potential or the greatest achievement so far are placed in sort of the top class. And students who are struggling are placed into a lower track. And then the question is, well, how do we focus our limited resources that we have? So it might be the case that teachers are going to focus more of their energy on the top performing groups, or schools are going to maybe allocate more of their budget to the top level classes, and the lower tracks might be seen as sort of a lost cause, not really worth the effort. This actually brings us back to a controversy in part of the bell curve by Richard Herrnstein and Charles Murray, in that they suggested that the right thing to do is to focus on the top tracks, because those are people with higher IQ have greater potential, and it makes more sense to invest your resources in them, and that investing your resources in lower performing groups is sort of a waste of time because they're unlikely to improve. So we might consider interventions that are designed to do just that, to focus on lower groups and see if you can spur improvements in those groups. And so we can consider programs like the Head Start program. This is a program that's aimed at young, struggling students, and the goal is to help them to catch up and reach their fullest potential. And the Head Start program is successful in the short term. So these students do actually make some rapid improvements, but unfortunately, other students catch up to them very quickly or even surpass them. And so it doesn't seem to be a long-term effectiveness, it doesn't seem to have long-term effectiveness for these groups. So we might wonder, just how much should we invest in these programs if the effects dissipate over time? So while there are positive effects of programs like the Head Start program, these effects dissipate over time. So then we might ask, well, maybe there's a way we could maintain them. How could we maintain the effects of these types of programs? Or is it not possible? Should we think of them as sort of a one-shot approach? Right? We do this program and hope for a long-term benefit, or maybe that's not possible. That's sort of like the holy grail of IQ improvement, is to have a short-term intervention that has long-lasting effects. And so far, it seems that that isn't something that we can really do, right? So this brings us to the question of how stable IQ is. Now, all of the students in the school that I mentioned in Rosenthal and Jacobson's study actually made improvements over the course of the year. And that might make us wonder about how much are we really assessing IQ in this case, because maybe the improvements were too great for it to be really measuring their IQ versus their achievement. So it did include, parts of the test include things like vocabulary, which of course you can always expand your vocabulary, but does that mean you're improving your IQ? But that sort of goes back to our problem of how we define IQ. So the question is, how stable is IQ? Is it possible for us to make long-term improvements in IQ? And this brings us to some research by Carol Dweck on what she calls fixed versus growth mindsets. This is an idea that's been really popular in education in the past couple of years. And the idea is that people who have a fixed mindset believe that their abilities are innate and unchangeable. So the idea of a fixed mindset is that your abilities are innate and you can't really do much about it. So they're innate and they're stable. They don't change. And this is in contrast to a growth mindset, which is the idea that abilities are malleable, that you can change them with the appropriate amount of effort. So you might wonder, well, how true is this? Well, it depends on what abilities we're talking about. And this brings up the point that Dweck's actually written about sort of the misapplication of her idea of fixed and growth mindsets, because people, some teachers and some school systems have been applying it as if you have one mindset, fixed or growth, and obviously we want growth, so we're just gonna tell all the students to have a growth mindset. And she says, that's not really what it's about, because this mindset exists for any ability you might consider. So you might have a fixed mindset in one area and a growth mindset in another. You might think of your athletic ability as being fixed and unchangeable, whereas you might have a more growth mindset when it comes to thinking about your math ability. And so the idea is you can't, in sort of one step, develop a growth mindset for all of your abilities. And when we think about whether or not our abilities are stable or changeable, we might think about sort of a range of potential. So I might think of my athletic ability as being relatively fixed in that I'm not going to suddenly become an Olympic athlete. But maybe there's improvements that I can make. So maybe I can still have a growth mindset while recognizing that, you know, there's a limit to how much I might be able to improve certain aspects of that ability. And this brings us to think about IQ in terms of, well, do we think of IQ as being innate and stable or more malleable? And I mentioned that it's really hard to find short-term IQ interventions that seem to raise IQ for the long term. But maybe this brings us to consider the difference between fluid and crystallized intelligence that I've mentioned in a previous video. So this is an idea from Raymond Cattell, and the idea is that your fluid IQ is sort of your ability to solve new problems versus your crystallized intelligence refers to knowledge that you've accumulated over time. And if we think about the stability of IQ in this way, it seems to be the case that fluid IQ is very, very difficult to change. There's not really any strong evidence suggesting that we can change fluid IQ over the long term. And this is something I'll talk about in a future video. But crystallized intelligence seems sort of obvious that you can improve that. You can always accumulate new knowledge and new skills. And even if your fluid intelligence is fairly low and maybe it's sort of you're kind of slow at learning new skills, you can still learn them, but it's going to take a lot of effort. And so we might think about the growth mindset as being useful when we're thinking about crystallized intelligence. We're thinking about specific skills and specific knowledge that we can accumulate over time. And that seems to be much less stable over time. You can always improve that. You can improve your vocabulary. And when we look at people over time, crystallized intelligence improves throughout most of your life, whereas fluid intelligence remains fairly stable and then actually begins to decline beginning in your 30s. But we don't notice this decline because your crystallized intelligence makes up for it because it's always improving. So that might be a way we could think about it. When we talk about the idea that IQ is fairly stable and unchanging, we might think of that as just specifically being about fluid IQ. And not giving up hope and saying, well, then I can't learn anything new or I can't make improvement, because certainly you can improve your crystallized intelligence. So even though we don't have evidence for, you know, long-lasting change in fluid intelligence, doesn't mean that you can't make improvements and you can't acquire new skills. Okay, I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.